Dark spots and patches or hyperpigmentation is one of the most common skin concerns. This includes post-acne marks, which can stay on your skin for months after your pimples are gone, melasma, which are large patches on your face common during pregnancy, as well as age spots. Today I'm going to talk about how to fade extra pigment and even out your skin, as well as some common mistakes that people make when treating pigment. I'm Michelle, I'm a chemistry PhD, skincare nerd, and genetically, my skin loves pumping out pigment. Thank you, Dad. Evening out my skin tone is a constant battle, so this is going to be a mix of science and personal experience. To understand how to tackle extra pigment, we need to look at how it forms, because different treatments target different parts of this process. It is most effective to target multiple steps at the same time. Pigment is produced by melanocyte cells, that is that octopus-looking cell at the bottom. It is at the base of the epidermis, which is the top layer of your skin. Your melanocytes produce a standard amount of pigment that gives you your skin tone, but hyperpigmentation is when they go a little bit haywire. Step one, the melanocytes are stimulated by something. It can be hormones like melasma in pregnancy. Some people also get hyperpigmentation from hormonal medications. It can be inflammation like a wound, that's post-acne marks. UV is also a big trigger. Step two is making more of the brown melanin pigment, specifically that's eumelanin. This happens inside little packets called melanosomes. But your skin doesn't look much darker until step three, when these extra packets are transferred to your normal skin cells or keratinocytes. The melanocyte cells have these noodly appendages that inject them into the skin cells. This spreads out that melanin. Finally, step four, as more skin cells get produced down here, the pigmented cells get pushed up through your skin layers. They make it to the surface of your skin, they shed, along with the pigment. Good riddance. Like I said, it's most effective to target more than one of these steps at once. Every treatment has pros and cons, and different things work for different people, so keep that in mind as we go through all these options. If there's anything I missed that you found helpful, please share it in the comments. Everything starts at step one. Some sort of trigger stimulates extra pigment production. If you don't limit this stimulation as much as possible, it's like you're trying to dry your hair in the rain. Everything else that you're doing just will not work that well. Obviously, this is going to depend on what is causing your extra pigment. If it's acne, you'll want to look into treating that. If it's pregnancy, you'll probably have to wait until your temporary tenant leaves. Genetics, we can't really do much about that yet. For irritation, anti-inflammatories and antioxidants can help. But the biggest thing we can all do for this step is sun protection. UV is the main external cause of extra pigment for most people, and a lot of pigment treatments can make your skin more sensitive to the sun. So before you do anything else, you'll want to get into a good sunscreen routine. This made a massive difference for my dark marks. I would say it was the most important product. Most sunscreens are good at blocking UVB and UVA2. These are what the SPF number measures. But for pigment, you'll also want a sunscreen that's good at blocking UVA1. These are longer wavelengths that get deeper into skin, and they tend to cause more photoaging, which is wrinkles and pigmentation. If you're in the US, unfortunately, your sunscreens kind of suck for this at the moment. You only have two ingredients that block it, and they're not allowed in the same sunscreen. That means you're not going to get the stacking of protection that sunscreens with the newer filters can do. These also make the sunscreen feel lighter and more comfortable to wear, so you can wear it more often. I have a whole bunch of videos about the details of sunscreens, but the most important points, make sure you apply enough of your sunscreen, about a quarter teaspoon for your face. A high protection sunscreen won't be high protection if you apply like a tiny swipe. You are trying to block out extraterrestrial radiation here. This is hardcore stuff you need. If you want to fade pigment, you can't just wear sunscreen to the beach. You'll want to wear it every time you step outside, maybe even inside if a lot of sun comes in. I have a video on working that out. Generally, you'll want the highest protection sunscreen that you can happily apply a lot of regularly. That means it should be comfortable and within your budget. UVA protection labels differ by country. You'll want the words broad spectrum or as high a number or as many pluses or as many stars as possible. It's a myth that mineral sunscreens are the best for pigment. If you're allergic to a particular chemical sunscreen, then you should obviously avoid it because inflammation does trigger pigment. But if you look at the highest protection sunscreens that are specifically designed for fading pigment, you will always see chemical filters in them because you do need chemical filters to get super high protection. Now for visible light, there is some evidence that intense visible light, especially blue and violet light, can make pigment darker. To block this out, you'll want a tinted product because iron oxides, which are the pigments used to create that sort of skin color in products, they are the most effective ingredient for protecting against visible light. They pretty much work like sunscreen ingredients, except they are absorbing visible light instead of UV. Visible light is only really an issue in sunlight, computers and phone screens, and indoor lights have way, way less impact. A tinted sunscreen that matches your skin tone is probably the best option, but foundation will probably work pretty well too. There are some other ingredients that are advertised for blue light protection, but the evidence for them isn't that great. You also want to layer your protection, as well as sunscreen, look into hats, sunglasses, and staying in the shade, especially when the UV index is really high. On to step two, melanin production. This is where most of the popular pigment targeting ingredients work. You'll hear the word tyrosinase a lot. It is an enzyme. It's sort of like a little chemical factory. It is responsible for several steps that turn the colorless building blocks like the amino acid tyrosine into the brown melanin pigment. It's the rate limiting component, which means that tyrosinase is like a little dumpling maker who has way more work than they should. There's heaps of dumpling filling and wrappers, so the tyrosinase slash dumpling maker is the bottleneck of the process. If you get rid of some dumpling filling or wrappers, it might not make a difference, but if you mess around with the dumpling maker slash tyrosinase, you get less pigment dumplings in your skin slash mouth. Hashtag science! This list isn't everything, but you can see there are a lot of ingredients for this. I say this all the time, but keep in mind that just because an ingredient is in a product, it doesn't mean that it's at the right concentration or in a formula that can help it get to the right part of skin, which in this case is the melanocyte. It is pretty deep. So when you're choosing products, look for ingredients that can work, as well as evidence like clinical data and reviews that shows that that product might work. Also, keep an eye on how it's actually working on your skin. The most common way that pigment treatments work is by competitively inhibiting tyrosinase at the active site. What that means is basically a lot of these ingredients are shaped a bit like tyrosine, so getting these near tyrosinase means that it has its hands full with things that don't turn into pigment. It's sort of like if you keep shoving pieces of round fabric into the dumpling maker's hands, some of these pieces also have superglue, you will get less dumplings. Some of these ingredients work in different ways. For example, N-acetylglucosamine stops tyrosinase from converting to the active form. A lot of plant antioxidants can chelate copper, which is just holding onto copper. Tyrosinase needs copper to work. So this is sort of like not teaching your dumpling maker how to actually make dumplings. A lot of these ingredients also work on more than one step, so antioxidants, for example, can help with step one. Hydroquinone is the most famous. It's often called the gold standard for pigment. It can also kill melanocyte cells and break down melanosomes, so it is best used as a spot treatment only on the dark areas. That way you can even out the color rather than just making everything go lighter and still having a contrast. There is a risk of permanently darkened pigment or ochronosis, but that is extremely rare, especially if you take breaks from the hydroquinone. It's also pretty irritating, but it is safe if you use it correctly. And because of these risks, higher percentages are prescription only, so a dermatologist can keep an eye on things. There are articles claiming that hydroquinone causes cancer, but it's only happened with larger amounts fed to rodents, and rodents process hydroquinone differently from people. It's been used for decades without any proper links to cancer coming up. There are also articles saying it's been banned in cosmetics in some places, but that's because it's usually regulated as a drug instead. Drug ingredients are usually banned in cosmetics. It's not like some huge scandal. With vitamin C, there are some different versions. I've gone into depth about the most effective and most annoying version, which is L-ascorbic acid, and how to pick out LAA products in this video. I will eventually get the video on derivatives out, but so far, these ones are my favorites. There's less evidence for derivatives working, but they are more stable and most of them are gentler than LAA. So the benefit there, less risk of triggering pigment. It is also a really good antioxidant. It soaks up free radicals, so you can use it during the day as well, again preventing step one. Azelaic acid, this also works to reduce melanocytes. It's very safe. It does sting my skin a bit, but most people find it really gentle. You do need a pretty high concentration though, like 10 to 20%, which tends to give really thick and sticky formulas. Arbutin is basically hydroquinone with a sugar attached. It is a weaker derivative. There's alpha and there's beta. The hydroquinone for this is like attached to either the top or the bottom of the sugar ring. Beta is the natural version. Sometimes it is just called arbutin. It is weaker than alpha arbutin. Glabridin is the key pigment targeting chemical in licorice extract. I don't love relying on natural extracts for like hard-hitting products that need to get deep into skin to work. There's just too much variation with what's in natural extracts. What's in it depends on how the plant was grown, where it was grown, how it's processed to get the extract, how it's been stored. I like boring predictability. So I look for if there's some sort of indication that the licorice extract has been standardized and tested, like if it's a brand name extract or if there's clinical data. Or I like it if they say glibridin specifically, even though I may be missing out on some of the other parts of licorice extract. Otherwise, I treat it like a bonus in a product. Now, before we keep going, let's talk about some common mistakes with pigment treatments. First off, not using sunscreen. If you aren't using sunscreen, you are not helping your products work, you are sabotaging them, you are giving your dumpling maker extra strong coffee while your poor product is desperately shoving fabric into their hands. I wouldn't even start on these treatments without getting into the habit of using sunscreen first. And just using sunscreen can even out pigment. If you don't have extra step one, then you don't get extra steps 2, 3, and 4. Not waiting long enough, I know patience is hard, but pigmentation starts from the bottom of the epidermis. It takes 1 to 2 months for the cells at the bottom to get to the top of your skin and shed. So don't give up on products after just a few days. You should be seeing some change after 1 to 2 months. 8 weeks is like the standard testing time for pigment products. But it can take even longer to see a real difference, especially for stubborn pigment that keeps getting re-triggered. By the way, this diagram is from my book, The Science of Beauty. It's very pretty because a real illustrator drew this. It's not just me doing dodgy cartoons on my tablet. There are lots of other awesome diagrams in this. It's pretty affordable. I packed as much info in here as I could. I spent so long changing sentence structures to try to just meet the word count. Went way over. It covers skin, hair, nails, makeup, beauty products in general. If you like my videos, you'll probably like this book. This video is actually based on one of the sections. You can check it out with the QR code or with the link in the description. Back to things that you shouldn't do that you're probably going to do anyway, but at least I tried. Ignoring irritation. Irritation can cause inflammation, which triggers pigment. It's often called rebound pigment. The pigment will fade a bit and then it's like you do too much and control Z. Some ingredients can be irritating while still fading pigment, but if you're not sure, like if it's a new product, it is probably best to back off and just ramp up slowly again rather than just pushing through and ending up with much worse pigment that takes way longer to fade. You can use the product less often or you can use less product until your skin gets more used to it. Just looking for tyrosinase inhibitors. This is a problem with a lot of skincare ingredients. A lot of them have in vitro data, so it works in a test tube, but not much data on actual skin. A lot of ingredients are tested on mushroom tyrosinase. The tyrosinase enzyme is extracted from mushrooms. Yes, they do have tyrosinase. And they mix that with the ingredient in a test tube and they see if the ingredient blocked tyrosinase. But the biggest problem here is that the ingredient might not actually be able to get into the skin deep enough to your melanocytes and they get to your human, I'm assuming, tyrosinase. So it's best to also check that the ingredient worked in clinical studies on humans or whatever species you are.
Take us to your leader.
I also wanted to mention bleaching treatments. In general, cosmetic products with these ingredients aren't going to make your skin lighter than your natural color if you follow the instructions, except maybe hydroquinone, which is a drug. Some people's skin does go lighter than it was, but usually that's because by default, we get a decent amount of sun and other triggers in our everyday lives. There are illegal bleaching creams though. These have things like mercury and really high amounts of hydroquinone. These usually aim to kill as many of the melanocytes as they can, which can lead to permanently patchy light areas. Plus, they can also damage other parts of your skin and they are toxic, like mercury is not a good ingredient. I would absolutely avoid those. Step 3 is melanosome transfer. After the melanin pigment is made, it's all still at the bottom of the epidermis inside the melanocytes. It's super concentrated and super small, so it isn't very visible until these packets of brown pigment, the melanosomes, get transferred to the keratinocytes. Those are the skin cells, and those then move up through your skin and they become more visible. There are less ingredients that work at this step. The main one is niacinamide. There are lots of studies behind it that are pretty high quality. It's also really gentle, which is just a nice change from all that irritation. There's also a bit of evidence that soy extract might work at this stage. Again, there is that issue with standardization when it comes to natural extracts. Step 4 is skin turnover. This is where the skin cells containing the pigment move up through the skin and shed. Speeding this up clears pigment faster. Retinoids speed up your skin cells multiplying, which dilutes and gets rid of that pigment faster. They can also act at other stages. For example, they are anti-inflammatory and they can reduce production of tyrosinase, which was our dumpling pigment maker. I have a bunch of videos going into detail about the different retinoids. The drug retinoids are more effective, but there are some downsides to them as well. Exfoliants also help dead skin cells shed. There are physical, chemical, and enzyme exfoliants. In particular, it's the chemical exfoliants, especially hydroxy acids, that are more commonly recommended for hyperpigmentation. Alpha hydroxy acids do make skin more sun sensitive, so make sure you are wearing sunscreen. It doesn't seem to happen with salicylic acid or polyhydroxy acids, but you should be wearing sunscreen anyway. Clinical procedures also usually work at this step. The main ones are chemical peels. These often use hydroxy acids, but also some other ingredients. The difference is they're formulated to be much stronger. They aim to remove a lot more skin. There are lasers which break up melanin, and they can reach deeper pigment than topical products that you put on top of skin. Is that where the word topical comes from? I have never thought about that. Lasers can also get skin cells to shed faster, and both peels and lasers are pretty intense treatments, which means that they have a higher risk of rebound pigment, especially if you have darker skin. There are gentler peels that are meant for pigment-prone skin, and also gentler lasers like picosecond lasers, which can lower the chances of rebound pigment, but with darker skin tones, they are still pretty risky. I'd recommend checking that the person doing the procedure has had a lot of experience on similar skin tones as yours with that specific procedure. There are other medical treatments for pigment, like I talked about hydroquinone before. Higher percentages are usually prescription only, but lower percentages are over-the-counter drugs in some places, like Australia, we have 2% hydroquinone. There are also triple combination creams, which are pretty neat. They use a retinoid, a corticosteroid, and a tyrosinase inhibitor. That means that it acts at steps 1, 2, and 4, plus the corticosteroid helps reduce irritation from the other two ingredients and stopping them from potentially re-triggering step 1. Again, it's that strategy of targeting multiple steps. Some of the skincare ingredients from before also have some evidence for working orally. And this brings me to tranexamic acid. I really need to get this off my chest. Tranexamic acid is pretty well supported by the evidence as an oral treatment for melasma. How it works isn't entirely understood, but it seems to reduce UV-induced plasmin activity, which would trigger the melanocyte, so step 1. Tranexamic acid is really hyped up in skincare products, mostly because it works well as an oral medication. I don't think that it actually works in the skincare products that I've seen. I am not convinced that tranexamic acid can get into the skin effectively without some sort of special delivery system because of its structure. So let's do a little detour into medicinal chemistry as a treat. You might remember that alpha hydroxy acids need to be at a low pH to get into skin. This was actually the topic of my very first YouTube video. At a neutral pH, they have a negative charge, and molecules that are too charged or too polar have a hard time getting into skin. Tranexamic acid has the acid group as well, so it needs to be below about pH 4.5 to be uncharged. But the problem is, it also has a basic group. This thing is called an amine, and at anywhere below a pH of about 10, it is charged. So that means at any pH, tranexamic acid is charged, and it is a small molecule, so this charge is pretty concentrated. It is just too polar, too non-oil soluble to get into skin effectively. This isn't a problem orally because things that are charged can absorb through your digestive system. And how well it works orally also adds to why I don't think it works that well in skincare. Even though there are some clinical trials where the results were statistically significant, you would expect that to happen even with ingredients that don't work if you test them enough. Tranexamic acid works well orally, it's cheap, it is pretty safe, and it's been around for a long time. It is exactly the sort of ingredient you would expect a lot of researchers to be testing. It is way easier to publish studies where something works rather than where something didn't work, so I am willing to bet that there are a whole bunch of unpublished trials where it didn't work. I have personally heard of at least 2 unpublished studies where it didn't work. There are products out there with tranexamic acid that have good reviews, but all of the ones that I've seen have other pigment targeting ingredients that have much more evidence. I hope you found this video useful. If I missed any tips, please leave them in the comments. I have more skincare videos over here. This QR code will take you to more info about my book, The Science of Beauty.